Hello interviewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode we're going to talk about LightSail. So let's dive right into it. Now let's look at overview, the science of it. Basically translation of that is very simple. You want large surface area, as large as possible, and you want to be as lightweight as possible. You cannot be like, okay, I have a large surface area, now I can be heavy. No, you want to be overall as lightweight as possible. So that's your requirement, that's simple requirement. And there must be something that is working on you, basically something must be pushing you. So in case of sailboats in sea, it's wind. In case of solar sail or light sail, it's generally photons. So these are the simple science of it: large surface area and lightweight. So what's the physics of it? Now physics is very simple. You have to understand it in this way, that light is traveling at light speed. So photons are traveling at light speed. So question becomes, how the heck it is possible? Because, you know, general relativity teaches us, if you to travel at light speed, you must require infinite energy. So how the heck photon is doing that? Basically, photon is 100% massless. It has no mass. However, it does have momentum, and momentum can be imparted. Utilizing that, we realized something very early on, is that light reflection is pushing you. So basically this TV has 100 watt of light coming out of it, let's say, and it's being pushed 100 watts of light equivalent on the backward. Again, it's earth, there is gravity, there is so much force on top of it, it will translate to nothing. Like, you will not feel it. That's why you do not go out in the sunlight and be like, you know, I'm being pushed by the sun. That does not happen. But when you are in space and you are very lightweight enough, that's why I keep going back to that point, you have to be lightweight, it can act on you. Over time, it can even accelerate you. So that's the simple physics of it. Now the biggest benefit of that is that if you want to travel in space, you still need a big rocket, and the bigger the rocket, the more fuel you need. The more fuel you need, the even more fuel you have to burn just to carry the fuel that you carried in the first place. So it's like a circular argument, basically a dog chasing its tail. Like, that's the reason why Saturn V, a rocket that is the size of a skyscraper, was mostly fuel itself. So that is the inherent limitation of rocket equation, but you can bypass it using LightSail. You can simply remove the fuel aspect of it, just the payload and the sail. So it will be, instead of like, let's say sending a 500 ton rocket which has like 5 ton of payload, you can have a, like, you know, 50 ton rocket which has 5 ton of payload. So you can improve the efficiency by a lot. So, and it also allows you to travel very fast, very fast. I am talking about a percentage of light speed that is like mind-bogglingly fast. So how the heck that is possible? Basically, you think of it this way: you have an astronaut, and your astronaut has a mass, and he throws the mass. Now this is normal rocket. Like, you go in space, you throw the mass, basically rocket propellant. Now problem is, light does not have mass. However, it does have velocity. Basically, it will impart momentum on you when it's being reflected. Now how fast light is traveling? It is traveling at light speed. So even though it has a very small amount of newtons, it does have higher final velocity. Basically, if you have a light sail that is being pushed by a significant amount of light over a significant amount of time, you will be traveling at very tangible percentage of speed of light. So it is even more faster than ion engines. So that is why people want to look into it. It's not just like, okay, it's a gibberish and all that. No, there is a tangible speed advantage. Again, it will take time to get you there, but it does allow us to do interstellar travel with current technology right now. Basically, if we start today, we will be done in like 100 years or something like that. I mean 100 years, like, we would be reached there. So how does this work in practical life, like in real life? Well, you need as lightweight as possible. To give you a context of this, think about this way. This sail is the size of a basically very big arena, basically, and like tennis court if you want, and it can be compacted into a size of a washing machine, even smaller than that. And on top of that, it's very lightweight. To give you a concept of it, think of this way. The sail they are using mylar. Now the specific mylar mixture that they have used here, it is 20 micron thin. Basically, human hair is a very fat compared to this. It's that thin. Like, it's a very, very thin. They want to make it as lightweight as possible. That's your first primary objective. Second, be as close to light source as possible, because again, light follows what we call inverse square law. So the further you go, the weaker it gets. So you have to be very close. So to give you a context of this, in basically solar system, you are on Earth, good. If you are on Mars, it's bad. It's like you lose a lot of power. Like, let's say you are in Jupiter, yeah, it's useless at that point because there is not enough light there. So what can we do? basically you have to be as close to the light source as possible, or you can create your own light source. You can have your own basically, let's say, space station that has torch pushing it up. So you can do that. That's how it works. Basically, you make it as lightweight as possible, put it as close to the sun as possible, and then make it as reflective as possible, because every light that is being absorbed by it, like nothing is 100% reflective. Every light being absorbed by this is heating it up. So you cannot go very close to the sun because you will simply melt. Even though you are reflecting, let's say, 99%, that 1% will melt you. So you have to make it as reflective as possible. So LightSail 2 is a very interesting project about this. You have to understand, LightSail is a tested concept. We have been using LightSail in deep space mission and all that. Like, it is a tested thing. However, LightSail 2 is unique in this regard, is that so far I have only found this is the only successful low Earth orbit mission. So it's a low Earth orbit. Now, the interesting part about low Earth orbit is that we send a lot of satellite in low Earth orbit. However, they do not last there. Like, flat out, because of the drag, it will fall down. However, this CubeSat, which was like basically 3U, so you can understand it, 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter by 30 centimeter. It just, for simple simplification, just think of it this way, like 30 centimeter ruler and 10 centimeter, like this, basically. Think of it this way, like this L size, it is the size. Basically, it's a big loaf of bread. Bit elongated. So that cube satellite is basically on low Earth orbit. However, it is doing orbit raising maneuver. Basically, it does not have any rocket engine like a monopropellant or ion engines like that, but it is raising its basically orbit height. Basically, it's making sure it's not gonna fall back, and it can increase like significantly. That's what they had to show. Like, not only the fact that, like, okay, LightSail works, it's like, can we controllably use it? Like, can we say, okay, by tomorrow we would have increased our orbit by 5 meters or 5 meters per second, whatever have you, like, you know, orbital velocity, and can you demonstrate that? This did that. That is why it's so interesting. And yes, that is a mini DVD in this. Yes, they have mini DVD of this. Like, every person worked on this was their name is put into that 8 centimeter mini DVD. So this was launched by a SpaceX mission, and it successfully did this. So it is very interesting and useful. Think of it this way: now you can have cube satellites that can stay in orbit for years, as long as their electronics work. So it is a very big development, very big development. Now, what are the uses of it? Let's say we build this, like, then the question becomes, why the hell bother with this? Because we do know how to make satellites, we do know how to make rockets, and they have been working. We have a space infrastructure, so why the hell bother with this? One simple reason: this will allow us to do a lot of add-on things. Basically, think of it this way: you have geostationary satellite, they carry a very small rocket with them for two primary reasons. Primary reason number one, they do station keeping. Basically, they always drift, there is always something happening. Gravity of things are moon and sun and all that, everything is affecting everything, and it's not very stable, so over time it drifts. So rocket engine is there to, like, okay, compensate it, like, you know, just take care of that. And at the end of life, basically, whatever the life may be, 10 years, 20 years, whatever have you, at the end of life, there has to, like, okay, my life is over, I have to fire the engine now at full burn and increase my orbit height, basically, from geostationary, that is like 36,000 kilometer, to whatever they can go, like 40,000 or 50,000, where to they will be permanently placed there in what we call graveyard orbit. They cannot go down because there is so much satellite going down that they cannot get a clear orbit path. So we generally raise it. So these are the two primary reasons. Now imagine that instead of having that rocket, now we have LightSail. First, the LightSail compared to a rocket system will give you much longer lifespan, basically, because rocket fuel is, while more powerful, while it does have the raw newtons, raw thrust, it does suffer from the consequence that your fuel will run out eventually. Even in ion engines, your fuel will run out, and sometimes it can run out if you you are in a complicated system. Your fuel could run out as quickly as 2-3 years. If you are using LightSail, technically your fuel will not run out. So that is a very big advantage for so many satellites that we want to put in the orbit. So that is a very big advantage. Second, solar observatory satellite. You have to understand, we rely on electricity a lot. Now, electricity and magnetism go hand in hand. They are tied together. So problem is that Earth has a magnetic engine. Basically, our core is a magneto core. It's producing magnetic shield that is protecting us from solar wind. Solar wind is charged particle. A side effect of that, you have charged particle interacting with basically magnetic field. It causes some awkward reactions. Now, generally, we only get a little bit of spray of charged particles, solar winds from basically sun, but sometimes sun gets extra excited and it does what we call coronal mass ejection. Like, a very significant amount of mass is ejected from sun, almost at light speed, not at exact light speed, but very fast, tangibly fast. Like, basically, instead of reaching us at let's say 8 minutes, it could reach us in 2-3 hours. Basically, it's ludicrously fast. And if that kind of mass ejection hits us, direct hits us, right now it has been like, okay, here, up, down, because sun is a 360 degree sphere and we are like a very small target from its vantage point. But let's say one hits us directly, it's like, okay, direct hits us, the interaction with our magnetic field will be so severe, it will roast out our entire power grid, every single thing. So we have to have a way to safeguard against that. The best and the simplest way we can safeguard is basically turn everything off and ground as many things as you can. So to do that, you have to know when to ground the basically when to do this. So we rely on solar observation satellite. Right now we do not have enough of that. Why? Because again, the orbit that we require to have it is very unstable. So we have to use a lot of rocket propellant to maintain the orbit, like not to place the satellite, to maintain that place. If we are using solar sail, we can maintain it for very long and we can have multiple of them to give us early warnings. So basically they will be hit and we can easily figure it out as early warning as 10 minutes, more than enough to press power off button, and sometimes as long as 2 hours to 3 hours, where you can be like, okay, shut down all the systems, safely transport everything in terms of, let's say, hospital, emergency care unit, do whatever they have to do. So it's quite important. Like, it's not something like nice to have. No, it is something that if we have it, it's good. And deep space probing. Now that may be problematic to most of you. It's like, I just talked about this, like how the heck you're gonna go far away by the distance as Jupiter is not gonna work. But here's one simple thing. We can do what we classify as gravitational assist. Now that name is kind of misleading, because using gravitational assist, all you can do is change your direction. Basically, like let's say this is Jupiter and you're going in, all you can do is like go up, go down. That's all you can do. You cannot increase your speed. So because if you are having a hard time understanding that, because movie shows us that way, is that think of it this way, like if to reach towards it, let's say it's adding 100 kilometer per second to you, it's like accelerating you. To leave it, you also need that exact same speed. Energy cannot be created nor destroyed, so you will be like, okay, I'm getting acceleration and I'm getting deceleration, so it will not add speed to you. So how the heck we do this quote-unquote orbital assist, basically gravitational assist? It's just that it's not gravitational assist, it's orbital assist. Basically we are leeching off the energy of the orbit, not of the spin, not of the gravity, but of the orbit. Basically we are leeching the orbital energy. It's like, okay, orbit is going this way, we are like, okay, just tug us along. Orbit is doing that, and because gravity is helping us doing that tugging without actually having a physical tug, that's why we call it gravitational assist. But it is orbital energy that is we extracted. So we slow down the planet wherever we are extracting. How much? Basically 1 inch in like few thousand years. In case of Jupiter is very huge. So like if we did not have done like Voyager and all that, Jupiter would have been like 1 inch ahead where it would be in few thousand years. So utilizing that, you have to realize the sun is also moving. Sun is moving very fast and it has ludicrously huge gravity. So we can send a probe directly towards a solar cell, directly to our sun, as close as we can get, and then using the orbital basically velocity, and we can just extend. The moment we are on the positive side, we can just extend the sail and get the acceleration. So the current mathematics is like, let's say if utilizing that, like, you know, go as close to the sun, that itself will accelerate you. Utilize the solar cells, so you do not lose a lot of the energy from gravity. We can reach to Pluto in around 5 years. So these are quite amazing facts. That's why I'm saying deep space probing can be done utilizing light sail, because we can go to the sun and we can go really fast and just deploy the sail once we are on the positive side and then enjoy the, you know, free boost. And we can go really far, really fast. However, you must be familiar with it. Like these sort of video are going around on YouTube and most of them are calling it laser. So why the heck we have lasers in our future? Well, you have to understand this. When I'm talking about light sails are generally interacting with light, and they have to interact with the whole electromagnetic spectrum. Problem with that is that you cannot build any material known to man that can reflect 100% of electromagnetic radiation. You just cannot do that. Physics does not allow you to do that. So to give you a context, like the infrared is a very wide band, like infrared is wide. So this infrared is reflected by aluminium, this is by gold, this by charcoal. So you have to understand this, like we cannot build anything that's like, oh, I will reflect everything. Even mylar, it reflects 100% of the visible spectrum, but not of everything else. So, and even in visible spectrum, it cannot absorb entire spectrum properly. So benefit of laser is that instead of having the spectrum, we slice it down. We are like this wavelength and we try to make it as tight as possible. So instead of wavelength having like a 500 nanometer to 2000 nanometer, we are like 501 nanometer to 510 nanometer. Like we make it as narrow as possible. Benefit of that, once you reach that kind of narrow range, you can reach 100% reflector. Now again, this 100% is quote unquote, but it's like 99.9 9999999937. That's how we can have, if you are familiar with maker industry or industrial laser cutters, they are generally CO2 laser cutter, infrared spectrum. So how the heck a laser that is cutting through like literally like sheet metals, like big thick metal, how the heck it's not melting the glass? Because it's a very narrow spectrum, like in terms of the laser output, it's very narrow. It's like barely 50 nanometers apart. We can design a specific coating that is like, I'm good at this, like gold generally. So you have to understand, every spectrum has some weakness, whereas like this spectrum cannot go through this material. So that is why we want to make laser. Benefit of that, we can pack so much energy into it. Basically, if you try to do this with a, let's say, normal light, because let's say you can make LEDs that 100% efficient, close to, and you're getting a lot of energy pumped into a small area, you will simply melt it. But if you have one specific spectrum of laser, you can reflect almost 100% of it. Benefit of that, you don't have to make the sail bigger. Benefit, it's lighter. And then you can get much higher acceleration. So you have to understand, even laser has a range. You cannot expect to fire a laser and like, let's say your laser is like a pencil thick, it will become a kilometer thick when it's at the moon side. So there is a limit to that. We cannot make laser beam that is 100% coherent. And even if you did start building in space, there is a mathematical limit to it. Basically, it does not have inverse square law, it does have quantum uncertainty. So light will go and spread apart. So best they can say, like even with like, you know, mega giga laser kind of scenario, you can only expect one light month of distance, after which the laser would be like, you know, just something like you can directly look into it and won't even blind you. So that is why people are talking about lasers, because we can reflect it with absolute certainty. It's like, okay, almost 99.99999% has been reflected, which is very necessary. If you're like, if you're watching this, like Stephen Hawking's proposal of breakthrough starshot, he was talking about like dumping gigawatts of energy, like literal gigawatts into the sail. You're gonna melt it. Like even at like 0.1% of wastage, you will melt it. So that is the reason we want a very specific laser. It's like, this is the laser and this is how we're gonna reflect it. So that is why laser is the future. If you really want to do, like, you know, don't rely on the sun all the time. So this was my presentation on light sails. I hope you liked it, learn from it. In that case, please click the like button. If you didn't like it, didn't enjoy it, I would urge you to press dislike, press it twice to show me your extra disappointment. And please leave a comment, because I reply to all of them. Subscribe, press the bell icon if you're free. And as always, thanks for watching.